morning. I trust you've had a reasonably good week. It's been a strange week, hasn't it? It's been a weird week, certainly in the world of politics in America. And hasn't it shown us just how unreliable systems are, politics are, people are? When you look at the disaster of the postal votes that happened in the States and the mess of all of that, and it's still going on today, but we have a God in heaven that we can trust in. We have a God in heaven who is totally reliable. And that's what we want to think about this morning, about trusting in God today as we come to 2 Kings chapter 7. Please remember, I'm sure most of you have heard by now, our dear brother Willie McCrory is in hospital. He had an accident during the week, and he had to be taken to the Royal Victoria Hospital. He had a broken leg, and thankfully he's through his operation. He's got a big cage on now, he's all pinned up, and they had him out yesterday, and I think that was quite sore, quite painful, had him up and on his feet. Imagine, just straight after the operation, there's no time to rest now, shouldn't it? But he wants to get home, and we trust and pray that he will get home very soon, and we want to pray for him and pray for Francis and the boys at this time. I called the other night and they're in good form, and Willie's in good form as well. While he's in a bit of discomfort, he's trusting in God, amen, and he's resting in him, and he's okay. So please remember, of course, Willie Owens at this time as well, and Sandra and the family, and then our Florence as well. We continue to pray for her and Nat and the family at this time as well. And all our loved ones, all our family. I'm sure you've got loved ones that maybe could do with a prayer, and we want to remember them, especially elderly parents. I've got an elderly mum as well, so I know what it's like. And we want to remember our loved ones at this time. Well, this is Remembrance Sunday. And this is a solemn time, but a time of rejoicing, because we are here today. And we have the freedoms today because of the men and women who were before us, gave their lives, sacrificed themselves to fight for our freedoms. For our liberty. So we want to remember them, and we want to thank God for them, those fallen and those that are still with us today, and maybe those who are suffering today because of war, because of strife and combat. We want to remember them today, that God would be gracious to them. So this is Remembrance Sunday, and we have a special tonight. James has worked tirelessly again. We want to thank James for his hard work again this week. He has pulled everything together. People have got involved, which is great. We have a special service going out at 7 p.m. so please tune into that, and you're in for a treat. And James will bring God's word. He will preach the gospel to us this evening at 7 p.m. and then remember our midweek Bible study on Wednesday evening at 8 p.m. Proverbs 3, familiar verse, or a couple of verses to us, 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. Amen. Well, let's sing together as our opening piece, as a hymn of praise, Ancient of Days. And as soon as we sing this, then our dear brother Adrian, one of our elders in the church, will lead us in our act of remembrance, and then bring us to the throne of grace, okay? And then straight after that, we're going to sing again, Abide With Me. So let's, I was going to say stand, but we're not standing. But let's join our hearts together. Let's sing Ancient of Days. Thank you.
Rage, and rise and fall. Let us all join together as the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You take your seats as we're going to sing Abide With Me.
Sing again a kid's song, I'm in the Lord's Army. Okay, boys and girls, shall we be ready? I'm in the Lord's Army.
Amen.
Huh? Okay. Isn't it good that we're in his army today because of his grace? That he abides with us every minute and every second of every day. Well, let's read God's Holy Scripture. 2 Kings chapter 7. Then Elisha said, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says Yahweh, tomorrow about this time a seah or a measure of fine flour shall be sold for one shekel, and two seers or measures of barley for a shekel at the gate of Samaria. So an officer on whose hand the king leaned, answered the man of God and said, "Look, if the Lord, if Yahweh would make windows in heaven, could this thing be?" And he, Elisha, said, "In fact, you shall see it with your eyes, but you shall not eat of it." Now there were four leprous men at the entrance of the gate, and they said to one another, "Why are we sitting here until we die? If we say we will enter the city, the famine is in the city, and we shall die there. And if we sit here, we die also. Now therefore, come, let us surrender to the army of the Syrians. And if they keep us alive, we shall live. And if they kill us, we shall only die." And they rose at twilight to go to the camp of the Syrians. And when they had come to the outskirts of the Syrian camp, to their surprise, no one was there. For the Lord had caused the army of the Syrians to hear the voice of chariots and the noise of chariots and the noise of horses, the noise of a great army. So they said to one another, "Look, the king of Israel has hired against us the kings of the Hittites and the kings of the Egyptians to attack us." Therefore, they arose and fled at twilight and left the camp intact, their tents, their horses, and their donkeys, and they fled for their lives. Verse 8, "And when these lepers came to the outskirts of the camp, they went into one tent and ate and drank and carried from it silver and gold and clothing and went and hid them. Then they came back and entered another tent and carried some from there also and went and hid it. Then they said to one another, 'We are not doing right. This day is a day of good news, and we remain silent. If we wait until morning light, some punishment will come upon us. Now, therefore, come, let us go and tell the king's household.' So they went and called to the gatekeeper of the city and told them, saying, 'We went to the Syrian camp, and surprisingly, no one was there, not a human sound, only horses and donkeys tied and the tents intact.' And the gatekeepers called out, and they told it to the king's household inside. And so the king arose, verse 12, in the night, and said to his servants, 'Let me now tell you what the Syrians have done to us. They know that we are hungry or starving. Therefore, they have gone out of the camp to hide themselves in the field, saying, "When they come out of the city, we shall catch them alive and get into the city." One of his servants answered and said, "Please, let several men take five of the remaining horses which are left in the city. Look, they may either become like all the multitude of Israel that are left in it, or indeed, I say, they may become like all the multitude of Israel left from those who are consumed. So let us send them and see." Verse 14, "Therefore, they took two chariots with horses, and the king sent them in the direction of the Syrian army, saying, 'Go and see.' And they went after them to the Jordan. Indeed, all the road was full of garments and weapons, which the Syrians had thrown away in their haste. And so the messengers returned and told the king. Then the people went out and plundered the tents of the Syrians. And so a seer of fine flour was sold for a shekel, and two seers of barley for a shekel, according to the word of the Lord. Now the king had appointed the officer, okay, on whose hand he leaned to have charge of the gate, but the people trampled him in the gate, and he died, just as the man of God had said, who spoke when the king came down to him. And so it happened, just as the man of God had spoken to the king, saying, 'Two seahs of barley for a shekel and a seah of fine flour for a shekel shall be sold tomorrow about this time in the gate of Samaria.' Then that officer," verse 19, "that answered the man of God said, 'Now look, if the Lord would make windows in heaven, could such a thing be?' And he said, 'Indeed, you shall see it with your eyes, but you shall not eat of it.' And so it happened to him, for the people trampled him in the gate and he died." So ends God's word. Well, let's sing together, boys and girls. Let's remember the actions. Okay, let's sing, "I'm in the Lord's army." Amen.
I'm in heaven, marching the infantry, riding the
good. If you can remember back to the images that was on display during the Act of Remembrance, the trench warfare during World War I exposed the soldiers to some of the war's greatest horrors. It was horrific. One army chaplain tells his story. One would think that such horrors would corrupt a soldier's faith in God. However, not only did faith help countless soldiers through the war, but their faith in God helped relieve the symptoms of shell shock. The graphic horrors of the trenches damaged many soldiers psychologically. One soldier told me he will never forget the smell of death, having to crawl through blood and dead bodies and flies everywhere. These were brave men. In the midst of war, many held fast to their trust in God, displaying great confidence in God during combat. One Christmas, I remember some of the men would pray out loud, "O Jesus, draw near, that even we may see the little child who knew no fear, thus would we picture thee." Many soldiers lost their fear of death due to the comfort of heaven. One of the verses they would get me to read to them was 2 Corinthians 4 verse 18. "So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal." Amen. You see, these men believed God's word, which brought them hope. And they trusted in God, the God of all comfort. And that made all the difference. So the question for us this morning is very simple. How can we trust in God? How can we trust in God today? In the midst of our needs, in the midst of our trouble, in the midst of coronavirus, how can we trust in God? Continue to trust in God. In the midst of war and the horrors of death, how did these brave soldiers, past and present, how can they keep their faith in God? How did they keep their faith? Well, it's interesting, the word trust means to believe, to have confidence in, to have reliance upon. Now you may be thinking, that's all well and good, Mark, but how can I trust? How can I trust in God today? Well, that forced me to look up then the verb, what trust means as a verb. And it tells me that trust means to rely on the ability, the truth, and the strength of. Okay? That's what trust means as a verb. To rely on the ability, the truth, and the strength of. So to trust God today is to believe in his reliability. Okay? It is to bank on his truth and depend on his strength, in a nutshell. Amen? And we could go on. It can also mean to live by faith, to walk by faith, trusting God every day, resting on his grace, enjoying his salvation, experiencing his peace, and dying with the hope of glory in our hearts. Do we have that this morning? Can we honestly say that we are trusting, truly trusting in God? Israel should have put their trust in God, but they didn't. They didn't. They failed. Remember, there was a great famine. War was waiting for them. The Syrian armies had camped around the city of Samaria, the capital of Israel, besieging it. There was no way in, no way out. And so the people were starving. Israel was starving. This was, in ancient times, this was the strategy. To surround, to besiege a city and to starve their enemy until they surrendered. And it worked. So much so that the people of God resorted to eating donkey's head. Remember we saw that last week? Donkey's heads for 80 shekels. They paid any price. They were that starving. And it was a non-clean animal. They shouldn't have been touching it. They shouldn't have been near it. But they were so hungry. They were eating donkey's heads, pigeons' dung or doves' dung. And to make matters worse, some had resorted to cannibalism, eating their dead children. We assume the children were dead. They should have turned to Yahweh the Lord. They should have put their trust in God. They should have repented of their sins. But they didn't. They didn't. They remained unfaithful. They remained unrepentant and hard-hearted. Superficial. Even the king offered no help, no leadership at their time of crisis. He turned out to be godless, gutless. He blamed God. He wanted God's servant, Elisha, dead, hunted and killed. We left the story last week with the king saying, verse 33, "This disaster is from Yahweh. Why should I wait for Yahweh any longer? Why should I wait on the Lord? Sure, look at the mess we're in. He's not coming to help." Here's what the king and the people of God forgot. Because of their sinfulness, because of their unbelief, they forgot, and we must never forget today if we are to continue trusting in God. Okay? Two things, very simple. Remember God's promises, and remember God keeps his word. He always, always keeps his word. Amen? Well, let's look at these together. Remember God's promises. Chapter 7 opens with this wonderful promise. "Then Elisha said, 'Hear the word of the Lord,'" or Yahweh. "Thus says Yahweh, 'Tomorrow about this time, a seah or a measure of fine flour shall be sold for a shekel, and two measures of barley for a shekel at the gate of Samaria.'" Wow. This wasn't the word of Elisha. This wasn't the word of a man. No, this was the promise of God. This was from Yahweh, the Lord. And he was promising that he would supply their needs. Isn't this amazing? Incredible. They should have remembered God's promises. They remembered that God would deliver them if they called out in faith and repentance. God would help them. God would come to their aid. But they didn't. They relied upon their own efforts. They relied on themselves rather than the Lord. And so they stopped trusting in God. And yet, in their unfaithfulness, God remained faithful. Amen. And within 24 hours, God promised deliverance. God promised that he would meet their needs. God would be gracious to his wayward people. They would have fine flour and barley to eat instead of donkey's heads, instead of dove's dung and human flesh. And notice that it's fine flour we're told here. Not just any old flour will do, but here we see fine flour, the best of flour. This is the God that we worship today. The God that is able to meet our needs and able to supply all that we ever dream or imagine. Amen. He was going to supply in abundance the finest of foods. But instead of faith, instead of rejoicing in Yahweh the Lord, Elisha found mocking. Mocking from the king's royal officer. Instead of faith, he found unbelief. Did you see that? Unbelief. Look at verse 2. "Look, if the Lord, if Yahweh would make windows in heaven, could this thing be?" In other words, there's no way that the Lord could do this thing or will do this thing. There's no way. Not even if windows were to be made in heaven and food. There's no way this is going to happen. Unbelief. Mockery. Criticism. Even though that the Lord had provided for them in miraculous ways in the past. Countless times. Even though this was an Exodus-like miracle. Yet, some still can't believe. The sad thing that we see here is that unbelief and mocking made this officer miss out in God's provision, in God's deliverance, and God's blessing. Skeptics always like to mock, always like to be critical, don't they? Skeptics always do. I'm sure you've come across it in your lifetime. If you've tried to share your faith with someone, someone who's a skeptic, someone who's a non-believer, And you find at times they like to mock, they like to be critical and cynical. We shouldn't be surprised at this. Remember that we are living in a post-Christian world today. Society has turned their back on God, turned their back on religion and on the church. Over the years, they've become cynical and skeptical, believing that the Christian faith is out of touch with our modern culture. This is why some have compromised themselves by allowing and conducting same-sex marriages in their church buildings. So, loved ones, we should not run scared of cynics. We should not shy away, because our God is bigger than any person. Amen? Our God is bigger than any system, any critic. The God who brought the word of judgment on his mocker, you shall see it with your own eyes, but you shall not eat of it, will have the final say in all things. Haven't we been seeing that through our studies in 1 and 2 Thessalonians? That on the last day, the judge of all the earth will have his final say. God's word can stand up to any cynic. We can trust God, and we can trust his word. Amen? Every Saturday morning, my father, my dad, would take my brother and me to the local leisure centre in Cookstown. And you see, he wanted to teach us how to swim. And I don't know if you've ever had that experience. It was quite a baptism by water, by fire, with my dad. And but here's the point. I remember being terrified of getting into the water as a young boy. Remember, this was before armbands. This was before any, you know, like, I'm showing the age here. Like, this is before there was any sort of rubber rings or anything like that there. I've got plenty of rubber rings now, like, but that was before rubber rings. And so Dad would get into the water first, okay, into the shallow end. And I remember him, he would get us in, coax us in. My brother was probably braver than me, from memory. But anyway, I got in. I was a big wuss, or a wee wuss at that time. And he would hold out his arms like this. And I'm sure maybe you have done this for your children. And he would hold out his arms. He said, "Right, Mark, I want you to lie over my arms. And so that you can feel what it's like to be on top of the water. And you can kick and you can flop your arms or do whatever you want. And I will hope you can trust me," Dad said. And of course, Dad was true to his word. Because every time I went over his arms and lay on top of him, or on top of his arms, on top of his hands, he kept me up. I never experienced going under. Sometimes he would go like this here. And I was like, Dad, that's up. But he was true to his word. He kept me up. That's because he loved me. He wanted the best for me. He wanted to teach me how to swim. And so, loved ones, this is the kind of faith God wants from us. Isn't it? Not blind faith, but faith that rests in his word, that rests upon his promises, because God is faithful, God is reliable, God is trustworthy. Promises like John 11, verse 25, "The one who believes in me, even though they die, shall live." Isn't that a great promise? What about John 10, 29? "My Father has given them to me." "My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one." Isn't that a great promise? No one, absolutely no one on earth will be able to snatch us from the Father's hand. What about Romans 10, 13? "Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." Amen. And maybe that's what you need to do today. Maybe you're listening in online and you've never called on the name of the Lord. You can do it this morning. And you can believe God's word Because God is faithful. God is true to his word, true to his promises. What about Hebrews 13? Never will I leave you. Never will I forsake you. Isn't that a great promise? Psalm, I love the Psalms. Do you remember Psalm 18? As for God, verse 30, his ways are proven. In other words, his ways are perfect. Perfect. He is a shield to all who trust in him. It is God who arms me with strength and makes my way perfect. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that a great promise? We need to be in the promises of God. We need to rest upon the promises of God. We need to hold on the promises of God and cash in the promises of God every day if we're to trust in him in the midst of this chaos, in the midst of this wicked, depraved world. Believing that not only his promises are true, but God is true because he is faithful, dependable, reliable. Here's point number two. Remember that God always, keeps his word. Always. This brings us to the story of the four lepers, the four unclean men with leprosy. We find these men sitting outside the city gates because they weren't allowed to go in. They weren't allowed to enter. It was forbidden according to Leviticus 13. They knew that if they remained at the gates, they would die. If they went inside the gates, they would also die. So they thought to themselves, well, listen, let's take our chances with the Syrians. And if we live, we live, and if we die, we die. Okay? And so they decide to go over to the camp of the Syrians and see what's happening over there. And here's the thing. Whenever they got there, whenever they arrived at the outskirts of the camp, they noticed that everyone was gone. There was no one about. The tents were empty. The only noise there was for the horses and the donkeys. It was deserted. What happened? Verse 6. Notice the miracle that God brought about in delivering his people. For the Lord had caused the army of the Syrians to hear the noise of chariots and the noise of horses and the noise of a great army. So they said to one another, look, the king of Israel has hired against us the kings of the Hittites and the kings of the Egyptians to attack us. And so the noise must have been horrendous. Imagine, it must have been. Do you ever lie in bed at night and you hear the odd wee noise and you're like, oh. You know, and maybe wakes you up out of your sleep and you're like, oh, goodness, what was that? You know, a bang, or especially over the last couple of weeks, all these firecrackers, or honestly, it cracks me up. It annoys me. I don't like them at all. These fireworks, that's the word, fireworks. I'm sure it must have been a nightmare for you, brother, whenever you were in the fire service, all these. But anyway, I hate them. Here, the noise here must have been horrendous. It terrified them so much so that they ran away and they left everything. They left it. And even whenever the guys went to the Jordan to see what had happened, there was stuff lying on the side of the road. They were that terrified. They wanted to get out of the way. They wanted to get across the border and into Syria again, where they'd be safe. Here's the point. Even though the Israelites did not deserve God's grace, God's provision, God's deliverance, God kept his promises. God kept his word. God provided salvation for his covenant people and these lepers. Every tent they went into, they found food and treasure, silver, gold, and clothes. And I thought this week, as I reflected on this, isn't this our story today? At least I hope it's our story today. Aren't we just like these four lepers? Aren't we? Think about it. We were spiritually dead in our trespasses and sins. We were unable to save ourselves, right? Unable to save ourselves because of our sinful natures. Because of our rebellion, our hard hearts. Living outside the kingdom of God. Blinded by our sin. But then we find treasure. In our sinful state, we find treasure, didn't we? Abundance of treasure. We find treasure in the Lord Jesus Christ. We find him to be more valuable than silver or gold. And today we are spiritually rich in Christ Jesus. Amen. Today, you and I, if you're a believer, if you're a Christian, trusting in God, then you're rich in Christ. Isn't that incredible? Rich in Christ. And here's the thing. You would never give him up. You've come to realize that you cannot live without him. That's how valuable he is. That's how precious he is. That's how much we love him. At least I hope we do. And here's the thing. We dare not keep him to ourselves. Notice these four guys, these four lepers became missionaries. They became evangelists to their own people. Do you see that? Isn't that incredible? Did you notice that whenever they came to their senses, verse 9, what did they do? They went back to Samaria, to the gates, and they told the king's household the good news, the great news. And so God used these four unclean lepers to bring good news of God's deliverance to Israel. Isn't that amazing? Brothers and sisters, if God can use these four lepers, then God can also use you and me. Amen? God can use us, ordinary people, weak, frail people. God can use us if we only make ourselves available to him and trust his word. Trust his in the gospel. Trust his character. We have a wonderful gospel to proclaim. We have a wonderful message. We have a wonderful word in the word of God. We have a wonderful God, haven't we? A wonderful God, a wonderful Savior in the Lord Jesus Christ, and a friend and a brother who sticks closer than anyone else, who will never leave us, never forsake us. Brothers and sisters, never be afraid to share your faith, to share your trust in God, your love story. No one can ever, I've said it before, no one can ever take it away from us. No one can take God's redemptive story in us away. Declare it, proclaim it, share it. People are dying today in their sins and they need Jesus. They need to hear where to find bread. One beggar telling another beggar where to find bread in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. How did God keep his word? Verse 16. When the people heard what the Lord had done for them, they plundered the Syrian camp. And according to the word of Yahweh, a measure of fine flour was sold for a shekel, and two measures of barley was sold for a shekel. Then in verse 17, the royal officer who mocked Elisha and the word of Yahweh was trampled to death by the people at the gate. Just as the man of God had said, who spoke when the king came down to him. You see, God always, always keeps his word. You see that? Always keeps his word. Never doubt the word of God. Never doubt the word of God. This is great news for you and I today. This is incredible news for all believers today, for all who are listening in and will listen in the days to come. This is great news for us, that God will keep his word and keep his promises for us. But it's not so good for unbelievers. Sure it's not. It's not so good for those who still reject the Lord Jesus Christ. The people of God experienced the blessing of God, the promises of God, the grace of God, the provision of God, the deliverance of God, while the skeptic and the unbeliever received God's judgment. He was trampled to death, just as the word of Yahweh said. That's a very solemn word for those who still reject Jesus. Galatians 6 and verse 7 says, God is not mocked. And this is the word of the Lord. God is not mocked. We must heed the word of God today and believe in it and put our trust in the Lord. And we can do so because He is reliable, trustworthy, dependable, and faithful. Faithful to his word, faithful in his promises contained within it. 2 Peter 3 and verse, I love 2 Peter and verse and chapter 3, verse 9, it says this: the Lord is not slow to fulfill his promises. Okay? He is not slow in fulfilling his promises, as some count slowness, but is patient. Why is God patient? Not wishing that any should perish. Not wishing that any should perish. And so today is a day of grace. Today is the day of salvation for you, if you'll come to the Lord in repentance and faith and put your trust in him. Today is a day of grace. He is patient with us. Not wishing that any, but all should come and reach repentance. Amen? Isn't that a great word? Tell me this morning, what will you do with this great news? What will you do? Will you believe it? Will you put your trust in the Lord? Or will you mock and reject the gospel? Reject the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who came to demonstrate love. God is love. The one who shed his blood on Calvary's cross so that our sins could be forgiven. What will you do? Will you believe it or will you reject it? And continue to live outside the kingdom of God. Brothers and sisters, loved ones, remember God's promises. Remember God always keeps his word. And we can trust in him. Amen? Amen. This is the word of the Lord. And may it bless us and encourage us and challenge us this morning as we seek to put our trust in him and to live for him and to share this great news with the world. We have a great gospel and a great message to proclaim. Well, let's sing together in closing another great hymn of faith in Christ alone. Thank you.
So
Thank you for your promises held within it. We thank you that you're a God who keeps your word, who keeps your promises for your people. And so help us to rest upon your promises today. Help us to hold on to your promises and to cash in your promises, especially whenever we're struggling, especially in our needs, in our problems, in our difficulties. Help us to remember that you alone are God. And we can run to you and we can find peace with you. We can find a refuge in you. We can find you to be our rock, our help, our ever-present help in times of trouble. We thank you that you're the God who promises to never leave us nor forsake us. You're the God who promises to be patient with us. You're the God who promises to save us if we will call upon the name of the Lord. And I pray this morning that you will help someone, that you will help many this day to call upon the name of the Lord. I pray today that you will grant them faith, that they will come and put their trust and faith in you, that they will come and rest upon your word today and upon the finished work of Calvary. We thank you for Calvary. We thank you for your Son, the Lord Jesus, Father. We thank you for how he shed his precious blood on that old rugged cross. And so give us the eyes of faith today so that we may put our trust in you and to walk with you with confidence, with boldness, and with great faith. And so, Lord, bless your people today. Wherever they are, Lord, whatever their needs may be, Lord, I pray that you're the God who can meet our needs. You're the God who can supply all of our needs today. And you're the God who can deliver us from coronavirus, from cancer, from sickness, whatever else we're facing. You're the God that we can put our trust in. For you alone, hold us in the palm of your hands. And our days are in your hands. And so, Lord, be with us today. Bless your service tonight. Bless your servant James as he ministers tonight. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that for the many, many gifts, Lord, for Joanne as she sings again tonight, for Testify as they sing, Lord, for wee Rebecca as she reads a poem, for others, Lord, for many in the church, Lord, thank you for this little church. Bless them. Bless our church family. Bless our brothers and sisters, wherever they are in the world, listening in online, those in the Philippines today. Bless them, Lord. And Lord, may this be a great day of rejoicing around your throne of grace, because someone has come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, thank you for Remembrance Sunday. Thank you for the men and women of the past who sacrificed themselves for our freedoms and liberties. Thank you for those of our armed forces and all the services, for our police men and women, for our firefighters and so on and so forth. Lord, thank you for them all, Lord. I pray that you'll bless them today and protect them and be with them. Now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Thank you. God bless you, and stay safe.